The west coast of Florida has a large problem at the moment with a red tide that not only kept humans out of the water for a while, but also killed tons and tons and tons of marine life. When I read the article about a week ago, they were already talking about more than 600 tons of marine life. We're talking dolphins, manatees, fish. Everything is dying because of this algae bloom. Admittedly, I spent the first hour after reading the article trying to figure out how to reach CNN about a problem with their article because they misclassified some things. We'll get into that. First, let's look at what red tides actually are. A red tide is a form of algae bloom. In the case of Florida right now, it's caused by a dinoflagellate called Karenia brevis. And as you might recall from our biodiversity segment on single-celled organisms, dinoflagellates are minuscule algae. They are teeny, 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 tiny plants with little flagella that help them move. So these little whisker-like things that they use like a whip to get around. Karenia brevis has two of those things and uses them to get around the area. If the conditions are right, these dinoflagellates reproduce rapidly and then something called a bloom occurs. So there are so many of them that in the case of Karenia brevis, the water just turns red. So you can see these red tides and you can actually see the problem even though they are teeny, teeny, tiny organisms. There are so many that they add up to be visible. If you look at the internet and you read articles about these red tides, you often see them named as bacteria. And Karenia brevis is a single-celled organism, but it is eukaryotic, so it's not a bacterium. It's a plant, it's a tiny algae. The problem is people just don't know single-celled organisms, and you know I don't care as much about them either, but they aren't all the same thing. You can't just lump them all together. That's not how this works. One big issue is that cyanobacteria are often called blue-green algae, and they cause another kind of bloom that we'll get into, but they aren't algae. So we've got Karenia brevis being miscategorized as a bacterium, we've got cyanobacteria, which are photosynthetic, so people assume they are a plant, but they're actually a photosynthetic bacterium, and everything just gets lumped together. They aren't the same thing. Red tides are caused by dinoflagellates, that's an algae. The blue-green algae blooms are caused by cyanobacteria, which are not an algae. I know it's super confusing, but it's just the way it is. We need to stop calling things by names they're not. Sea jellies are not jellyfish because they aren't fish, and Karenia brevis is a dinoflagellate and not a bacterium. If you go to the supermarket and get spirulina powder, you actually don't get an algae powder like people tell you, it is cyanobacteria again. So you're actually getting a bacteria powder, which sounds totally weird, but it is what it is. Cyanobacteria are everywhere. We already talked about them in the single-celled organism segment, so I'll keep this super brief. They are a bacterium that is adapted to every situation that you can find on this planet. They are everywhere in the water and on land. They are even part of lichen. So if you walk the tree and you see these little mushroomy things that cover the tree, cyanobacteria and a fungus. So they are everywhere and they are really, really good at surviving. One of the main things is that they aren't only photosynthetic as in take carbon, make oxygen and energy, they can also fix nitrogen. So when the carbon is used up, they have another source of energy that they can use to produce what they need. So when all the other blooms are over, cyanobacteria still gets a chance. But back to blooms in general. Blooms come in many forms, shapes, sizes, and they can be anything. They can be red, they can be green, they can be blue-green, they can be transparent and just have this little film on the top that looks like you dumped oil in there. They can be foamy, milky, they have all these different kinds of characteristics. But one thing they usually share is that they are pretty deadly to the other organisms in the area. You could probably even consider it a bloom when sea jellies take over an area, but for today we'll focus on the tiny organisms calling algae blooms or bacterial blooms, because those are mostly just underestimated in their effects. People just don't know that it matters if the sea is foamy or if it has a film on top of it, if there are giant green or red or whatever slimy substances everywhere. They just think that's normal. The problem is it is normal only to a degree. They happen every year. These blooms happen in spring when the water temperatures like get a little better. They happen after storms when a lot of nutrient-rich waters come up from the lower levels of the ocean, things like that. They are normal. These blooms happen in nature. But we humans have kind of thrown the system off by just adding nutrients to the water where it doesn't belong. No matter which organism causes the specific bloom or tide or whatever you want to call them, they are typically pretty deadly to the other organisms in the area. In the case of cyanobacteria, the cyanobacteria itself is toxic. It can even harm humans. So if you have an area where there's a cyanobacteria outbreak, they usually close the area off for swimming. In our case of K. brevis, the red tide dinoflagellate, the organism as well releases a toxin. So those are ones where the thing itself is toxic. So if there's a shit ton of it around, it can make things pretty hard for the other sea life. So not only does it kill fish and dolphins and manatees, it also acts on the shellfish and then is accumulated in the shellfish, which humans then eat and then or other organisms eat. And that's not good either. In other cases, the blooms are deadly because they use up the oxygen. So there's not enough oxygen for the other organisms in the area to breathe and do their thing. Yet other ones are just overwhelmed. So there's just so many that the rest of the organisms just get pushed away and they can't compete for the living space. Either way, not good for the other organisms. As I said, to a degree, these things happen all the time. Storms bring up nutrients through upwelling, summer brings warmer temperatures, things like that. But in a lot of cases, we are adding imbalances to the ecosystems. In the case of the red tide off the coast of Florida, there's actually a phosphate mining plant right there that had a problem. The Piney Point phosphate plant had some trouble earlier this year. I think it was May, but it doesn't matter. So they had this reservoir that was close to overfilling, and they were scared that it would burst. So they moved some of the wastewater into storage tanks, but also some into the ocean. And this is thought to have made this year's red tide so much worse. While there are no studies on this or anything you can actually rely on, people who have lived in the area have said that it's the worst red tide by a long shot that they've ever seen. And you see all those like articles of and interviews with people in the area talking about how many dolphins and manatees, which are animals that humans seem to care about, are just dying. And that's not even considering all the things humans don't care about dying. Yeah, we throw things off balance, and in this case, it's causing huge red tide and 600 tons of marine life dead. We're good at this. If you get store-bought fertilizer for your houseplants, you'll realize that phosphate is one of the ingredients, at least typically, alongside nitrogen, some minerals, and some other things plants need to eat. So when you add those as wastewater into the ocean, you're throwing everything off balance and adding more plant food. And the first organisms that are able to use all of that to reproduce are algae and other tiny single-celled organisms like cyano. But even if there is no big spill to blame for an algae bloom, humans are typically to blame at least partially. As I said, some of this is natural, we're just making it worse. So when we have agricultural fields or industry wastewater and we throw fertilizers and detergents and all that into the water, then let that run off into rivers or streams from there into the ocean, we're just adding imbalances to the nutrient balance in these ecosystems. It's just not the way nature intended it. So our agricultural obsession where we have fields everywhere and then throw all these chemical fertilizers at them just makes things a lot harder for nature to keep the balance. Nature had a system going with the blooms having a specific pattern and things working out well. Yeah, and then humans entered the whole thing and made things just not work out the way nature intended. The problem with phosphate is that it moves through the cycle very, very slowly. If you look at the natural phosphate cycle, it relies on plate tectonics. That's the movement of Earth plates, which is a really, really slow process, like super slow, slower than you can imagine slow, to get it back to the surface. So it runs off through rivers into the ocean naturally. That's totally normal. Goes into the groundwater and gets into organisms and all that. And then at some point ends up in the sediment at the bottom of the ocean or river, from there into the rock layers. And then plate tectonics move it back up. When we mine phosphates, we're speeding up the whole moving it up phase, which means that there's a lot more phosphate in the rivers and oceans and all that at a certain time than there should be. In addition to like fertilizers, agriculture, industry and all that, there's also detergents. The detergents we use to wash our clothes or to clean our dishes are typically full of other nutrients that are throwing things off. So in addition to the typical advice to educate yourself and others and to vote at the booth and when you buy products at the store, I'll also ask you to check your cleaning materials. Are your cleaning materials eco-friendly? Are they good enough? And if you're not sure what to look out for greenwashing wise here, there's a video on my channel on what greenwashing is and how the companies use it to trick us into thinking we're buying something that's better than it is. So try and replace your cleaning agents with agents that are actually good for nature. Well, there aren't any ones that are good, but ones that are less harmful, I guess. So just try and minimize the impact your cleaning routines and your washing routines and all of that are having on the environment. For example, laundry detergents. We don't use a laundry detergent here. We use soap nuts or wash nuts, and that's just a natural detergent that actually comes from nature. But no matter how well chosen your cleaning detergents are and your soap and your whatever are, you will always have an impact on the waterways. So try and only use as much as you actually need and try to minimize your impact that way. Check that you're using the right kind for where you are and the water's qualities that are in your area, try and use the right amount and all that. And maybe try it out for yourself a little bit. A lot of the time we don't use any detergent, not even soap nuts, when we wash our clothes. If there are no stains on it, and I know I'll be hanging it up in the sun after, there really isn't that much of a reason to use any kind of detergent because the sun has wonderful antibacterial properties, the water will do most of it and the sun will do the rest and nothing ever smells or whatever. So of course I wash with detergent most of the time, but if there's nothing in there that needs it, I just throw it in the water and that's it. So just evaluate what you actually need and try and minimize what you use. As always, I have babbled enough and I'll let you go here. If you want to support the show, go to katehildenbrandt.com/support where you'll find monetary and non-monetary ways to support me. I'm an independent creator, so I do need your help. Whatever you do, I appreciate every single one of you, your comments, your likes, your donations. You guys rock. As always, stay fucking vigilant and see you next time. Bye, friends.